And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world, for witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come.
You are welcome to another edition of this television program, The Kingdom Word, coming to you from the Kingdom Mission Support Foundation. And we have been considering a topic, the building of the last temple. And at the last episode, we are considering the fact that God is visiting His church again. We did say that this visit of the Lord to His church has to do with the Lord inspecting His church, and He's building His church, He's restoring the glory of the church, He's making things to be restored as He had it in mind. He's drawing a line, the line of the surveyor, the line that will demarcate true worship from false worship, all because of a lot of mixtures that we have now. We want to go further and look at the phenomenon of this restoration work, the phenomenon of the building of this last temple. Now, because there are quite a number of misconceptions among God's people. So if we look at the book of Haggai chapter 2, I'll read from verse 6. It says, "For thus saith the Lord of hosts, yet once it is a little while, and I will shake the heavens and the earth, and the sea and the dry land. And I will shake all nations, and the desires of all nations shall come. And I will fill this house with glory, saith the Lord of hosts. The silver is mine, and the gold is mine, saith the Lord of hosts. The glory of this latter house shall be greater than of the former, saith the Lord of hosts. And in this place will I give peace, saith the Lord of hosts." Now, the Lord actually is doing a work of restoration in His house. Now, this Haggai chapter 2, verse 9 is well known by many scholars, Bible scholars, many Christians and people who are expecting God to do great things in their lives. Quote the scripture. While the scriptures can be applicable for multiple situations, we have known about people who quote the scripture saying that maybe they were involved with a job before and they have another job, and they quote it that the glory of this latter job, the glory of this latter house shall be greater than of the former. Fine, if God has given that scripture as an inspiration, but let it be known that this scripture was birthed in the spirit of prophecy because of the restoration work in the house of the Lord. And what was the Lord saying? The Lord was saying, because there are people who were discouraged because they saw the glory of the former house, the temple of Solomon, and they saw the new temple that was being raised up under Zerubbabel, Haggai, and Zechariah, and they wondered whether there was any way it could match with the former one. And the Lord said, the glory of this latter house, mind you, He says, the glory of this latter house shall be greater than that of the former. Let us understand that He wasn't speaking about the glory of the house or the temple of Zerubbabel. For even by all means, it was not greater than that of Solomon's temple. But we know, we did say, that this temple of Solomon, we did treat this in a previous episode, the temple of Solomon was symbolic of the Pentecostal church. For so many reasons. One, that was a temple and singularly honored with the presence of God. There was so much of the glory, anointing, and presence of God. So much so that the priests had to run out. They were not able to function. The glory of God took over, which is symbolic, which is also what has happened, in the Pentecostal outpouring. Now, also, we saw that there were 120 priests that blew the trumpet. 120 priests that blew the trumpet in the temple of Solomon. And there were 120 in the upper room that began the heralding of the new message. A message, you know, is also, trumpet is symbolic of a message. So we see that the Temple of Solomon was actually symbolic of the Pentecostal church. Now, many of us have seen the glory of the Pentecostal movement. We are still seeing the glory today. Baptism of the Holy Spirit, signs and wonders, miracles, in-depth teachings of the Word of God, unveilings of revelation truths. Now, but you see, just as the Temple of Solomon was corrupted, the Lord wants us to know that the Pentecostal court has been corrupted. It has been corrupted. If you go to Ezekiel chapter 8, you will see four different sets of abominations that took place in the Temple of Solomon, for which the Lord caused that temple to be taken to be raised down and the people taken to captivity. So there are abominations that have taken place from Azusa Street Revival in 1904 till this time. We can say that a lot of abominations have taken place in the house of the Lord, in the Pentecostal outpouring. And the Lord by this is saying that there is a new house that is being built. There is a new temple. There is, because the temple is symbolic of a people, not a physical structure. Now, but so it is necessary for us to know that the glory that God is talking about is that there is a new work of the Spirit as a result of the Lord inspecting his house. There is a separation going on, and there's a new work of the Spirit. There is a new crop of people of God. There's a new group of servants of God that are being raised up in the house of God. Now, but these ones, the Lord will anoint with his glory. So there is a new temple, there's a new house being built. And the Lord said the glory of this latter one, this work, shall exceed that of the former. Now, so let me tell you part of how this will be. Now, we are seeing God turning to the people that are not known, people that are not recognized. But in the former times, we have had people, presence in the Church of Jesus Christ, who were well known, noted for performing miracles, even if there was no miracle in sight, in view, their very presence stirred up miracles because they had the reputation of having worked with God. But many of these ones have fallen upon the laps of Delilah. Many of these ones have turned the anointing into money, have sold the anointing for money. So the Lord is turning to simple people, people that are not even known. People that when people mention their names, you say, I don't even know these ones. Now, these ones are there's a crop of new temple that God is raising up at this last time, at this end of the age. So the Lord is now saying that the glory that will be battered upon these ones shall be greater than that of the former. Of course, the ancients should not be angry at that, because there is no father that does not pray that his child should be greater than him. Nevertheless, God is doing this as a result of the inspection. There are those that God has trusted with his grace and anointing and have messed it up. And God is turning to people that don't even have a name. We're going to witness in this last hour a crop of young messengers, ministers of the gospel that do not have a pedigree, that are known. But you will just be hearing sporadic outbursts of great works of the Lord, signs and wonders. Because these ones are simple. Many of these ones have been prepared like David in the bush. Some people will just see them. They may not know what has taken place in the days of their preparation. Many of them, while they are the older ones, we are busy feasting, you know, and wining and dining, you know, with Delilah. These ones have been prepared like David. David went to the battlefield. And when he got there, his brothers were angry. He said, what did you come to? He just came to poke nose. But this boy had been prepared. And Saul told him, he said, look, how do you know that you can confront this Goliath? He said, well, I was in the bush. I was taking care of my father's sheep. And I saw a bear came to devour the sheep. And the Lord delivered the bear into my hands. And I tore it to pieces. And another time, a lion. He said, the God that delivered me from the lions and the bear. Now, mind you, even his brothers probably didn't know that David had fought lions and bears inside the bush. So there are people today, I can tell you, there are a crop of young ministers and servants of the Lord that God is training. They are fighting with their lions and the bears. They are going through excruciating experiences of divine training. And the reason why God is allowing many of them to go through crucible is because of the glory, the kind of work he will use them to do. Joshua succeeded where Moses failed. So a crop of this new breed of ministers are going to succeed where many of the older ones have failed. Now, it is this glory that is coming as a result of God's inspection upon the people that are just, the people that are not known, recognized. Now that God is saying shall be greater than that of the former. The anointing upon this latter house, the glory that shall be seen upon the church. Hitherto, we have seen one man being used. You know, we see head and shoulder government. Saul was symbolic of a head and shoulder government, but David was symbolic of a government that was plural. You will always read and hear about David and his mighty men. You will never hear of Saul and anybody with him except Jonathan, his son, whom he even cursed at the time. So Saul was all by himself. He was pleased to be the only one known. The Bible says he was head and shoulder above every other person in Israel. He was the only one that must be seen. And that is the spirit that God is rebuking in the church. The spirit of one man ministry. The spirit of one man seeking to be placed alone in all the earth. The spirit of one man carrying the show. The spirit of one man only having anointing and not wanting any other one to come near him. That spirit, the Lord is rebuking it. The reason is because one man ministry can never accomplish the purpose of God. So God is turning unto the Davids. Oh, the Davids, the plural body of young people who have had experience with God, who have had their secret training that God is now using, and God will use to bring down this Goliath that has threatened and terrorized the church, his people. Now, these people, the Lord knows them and is working on them. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, from verse 26, 27, it says, you see your calling, brethren, how that not many mighty are called, not many wise are called, not many nobles are called. He said, but God has chosen the weak things of this world to confound the ones that are strong. He has chosen the small things of this world to confound the ones that are big, so that at the end of the day, no man will glory in his sight. We have seen God pour anointing upon many of his messengers in this nation and all over the world, and they have gone, and they have become proud. Many have walked as though nobody anointed them. The Bible says, look, what is it that you have that you have not received? Many of them don't want anyone near them. If they are traveling, woe betide you if you move around them. You know, these are servants of God. Many of them, God picked them from nothing. And having been anointed, some of them entered into wealth, some of them by good means, some by bad means. And many of them have become Lord and Master. Nobody can talk to them. Even when they are making mistakes, nobody can talk to them. That was Saul. That was the head and shoulder government. But we remember David. David was with his mighty men. David took counsel. We see even when David wanted to do certain things, the sons of Zeruiah will counsel him and tell him, do we do this? At times he said, no, don't do that. You see Joab at times, will come in. David wanted to number the people. Joab came and said, no, don't do that. God has said we should not do that. And that was the reason, because he did not listen to Joab, God punished him and punished the whole of Israel. So we discovered that David was with his mighty men. David had a covenant relationship with a crop of people. That's why the Bible often speaks about David and his mighty men. At the time, David was thirsty and he wanted to drink water. And there's a particular water in the land of the enemy he needed. And because these people were so committed to him, they risked their lives to be able to get this water for him. And when David got that water, he lifted it. He said, no, this is the blood of men that have jeopardized their lives to get me what I need. He said, I am not qualified to drink this water. He poured it out unto the Lord. That is not what many of our servants of God today will do. Many of the servants of God today, even they even tell you, you are not giving them enough accolade. You call them brother, you are in trouble. If you call them pastor, you must add senior to it. If you call them bishop, you must add archbishop to it. Now, but God at this time is turning to the Davids, the simple ones,
You can watch past episodes of Kingdom World on YouTube through www.youtube.com/user/KingdomWorldOnline. Also visit www.kingdomworld.net for MP3 and other Kingdom resources.
You know, when Samuel was to anoint, you know, to David. Remember, after he went to the house of Jesse, and he called for all the men, seven brothers came out. And when by the time he had said, Jesse, are you sure you don't have any other person? And he said, well, there is one. It's somewhere. Let's forget about that one. We don't reckon with that one. And then, like, there are so many issues they had with David. And there are many people today that God has his hands upon. God, they have prospects in God. But people have so many issues with them. But God is saying, just like Samuel said, we will not sit down until he comes. And there are people that God is waiting for. He will not rest. He will not rest until these ones emerge. Until these ones come out of the various, you know, things, thickets that they have locked themselves in. Now, but God is raising a spiritual body that will carry the last lap of this kingdom work. Praise the name of the Lord. So as we look at this Haggai chapter 2, we have to understand the phenomenon of the building of this last temple. It is the glory of this last temple that shall exceed that of the former. It is not the administrative structure, nor the physical aesthetics that shall be greater. We need to explain this. What do we mean by glory? The word glory is taken from the Hebrew word for glory is kabod. It means a force, a power. Now, when Moses came down from the mountain, after going to receive the tablets of the law, the Bible says that when they saw his face, it was as though, you know, there was a glory. But there is a particular old translation that says it was as though his face shot out horns. H-O-R-N-S. Horns. So that was a kabod. That was a glory. This glory, it speaks, the word kabod also means a weight. It speaks of a divine presence, a divine representation, a divine power and force. Now, it is this kabod in the Hebrew, of this latter house, that shall be greater than that of the former. Now, but we see that people are misrepresenting and misunderstanding the scripture. Many are thinking that it is the administrative structure of the latter house that shall be greater than that of the former house. We say no. Now, let us know it. What do we mean by administrative structure? We are talking about hierarchical structure, where you have the archbishop, then you have the bishop, and then they have reporting to him, the reverends, and then the pastors report to the reverends, and the deacons report to the pastors, and the whole thing is so distorted that there's a lot of confusion in the house. Now, and many are so happy. They say, look, the glory, the work is moving so much that, look, we have to really strategize the work. We have to ensure, you know, that we put things. It's a complex administrative structure, yes. People are bringing the principles of human management systems into the house of God. While some, I use the word some of them, could be applicable, we cannot swallow the pills of the world and use it to attend to the matters of the kingdom of God. It's not possible. Now, if you look at the concept in the scriptures, in the economy of God, you see, the concept of money in the Bible is different from the concept of money in the financial world today. So if you try to bring the concept of money and money management in the world to the church, it will not work. The reason is because the financial system of the world has no place for the poor. In this financial system of the world, the rich will get richer and the poor will get poorer. But that is not the financial system in the church. We are talking about the fact that the glory of the latter house is not the administrative structure. Now, in the financial system of the kingdom of God, the poor should be cared for. The rich should release what they have to the poor,
And when the poor come up, they also help the other poorer ones that are coming behind them. So we see a lot of administrative structures in the many denominations and churches today that are not scriptural. If you are talking about ministry, only one man ministers from A to Z. I remember, the Yonggi Cho was given a testimony at the time when he ministered, preached so many, about almost 4 or 5 sessions of preaching one day, and after it, he had to baptize about 200 or more people. After about sessions of ministry, and after that day, he collapsed. When he collapsed and he was recovering, many of you may have read about it, he was recovering from the sickness. The Lord now told him, you can't do this work alone. Now, we see that the administrative structure in the Church of Jesus Christ gives room for one man to be placed alone. The man is the one who has the vision. The man is the one who controls the finances. The man is the one that preaches on the crusade. The man is the one that takes the ministers' conferences. The man is the one. The days of one man is fading away. We are in the days of the Davids of God. That is why in Psalm 89, verse 20, the Lord says, I have found David, and with my holy oil, I have anointed him. There is a body of people not known, but fighting with lions and bears in the bush that God has been waiting for to emerge. I can give you good news that these people are emerging right now. And God can confidently say, I have found David, my servant. That David is a Davidic body that shall bring victory to the house of God. He said, with my holy oil, I have anointed him. It is the anointing with this holy oil that shall bring, that is the glory of this latter house. Now, but we see that the church is more concerned with complex physical aesthetics. What do you mean by physical aesthetics? Big church buildings, complex administrative structures. Both the administrative structures and the physical structures are not that which shall exceed the former, but it is the presence of God. We are going to witness on the earth today in the Church of Jesus Christ the emergence of men and women who have committed themselves to God, who have dedicated themselves to God, who have not defiled their garments with money or with immorality, who are going to exercise and exhibit a level of kabod, a level of a weight of glory that the church has never even known. To the extent we can quote the scriptures, that what happened in the early church will be child's play, whereby we are going to have a numerous number, sizable number of God's people moving across geographical boundaries, doing great works, not only in the numbers of people that shall turn to God through them, but in the quantity of the quality of divine presence that shall attest their lives and that shall attest their ministries. These ones are coming up, and may the Lord cause them to quickly imagine the name of the Lord Jesus. Now, the church is advised. Denominations or assemblies of God's people are advised not to shift the emphasis from raising spiritual men to raising spiritual and to raising physical structures. Now, the issue is this. At this time, a lot of emphasis is placed on physical structures, complex administrative structures, and when you get to some church organizations, they have almost 26 different arms and divisions. And some of these things are so complex that the Holy Ghost finds it difficult to operate through them. Let our administrative structure be so simple. The early church had a very simple structure. It was so simple that everyone's voice could be heard. It was so simple that it gave room for anyone that had prophecy to prophesy. It was so simple that it gave room for people, ordinary people in quote, to exercise the gifts of the Spirit. It gave room for people, for gifts of the Spirit, for ministries to emerge, because there was no apex person or structure. Now, so we have to understand, but what is happening is this, that we're emphasizing building administrative structures that are complex and complex physical structures, that there's a lot of distraction on the reason of physical human beings. So, what is the emphasis of God at this time of the end? In this building of the last temple, it is the raising up of men and women who have separated themselves unto God and who have opened themselves up to the Lord to fill them with his mighty spirit, and through whom the Lord will reveal to the world who Jesus Christ really is. For that is the intent in the heart of God, that the world might know who Jesus is. Now, let us repent. Turn from our evil ways. It is because we have burdened ourselves with complex structures, and we need a lot of money to manage these structures, that we have not gone haywire in the way we raise money. We have never read that the early church was making launchings